Hello there. In this video, I'll go over a number of ideas that are discussed in Milroy and Gordon 2001. The book is called Sociolinguistics, and the chapter is called Language Variation and the Social World: Issues in Analysis and Interpretation. And as the first slide here suggests, the most important concept that I'll be talking about is the sociolinguistic variable, but there are actually a few more things that I want to present. So first of all, I'll talk about sociolinguistic variables and give you a couple of examples, also data examples for that. And then we'll talk about social categories, things like class, gender, ethnicity. And it's important to keep these two apart, sociolinguistic variables on the one hand and social categories on the one hand. Sociolinguistic variables are about ways of talking, and social categories are amongst the factors that explain why people talk in these different ways. So social categories, although they influence language, they are not in themselves linguistic. They are more general than that. All right, and at the end of the video, I'll give you a little summary and present some conclusions. Right, let's start talking about sociolinguistic variables. A very simple but very fitting definition of a sociolinguistic variable would be that when people can say the same thing in different ways, then you have discovered a sociolinguistic variable. Right, a bit more formally expressed, you could say, right, when we have a linguistic category, and this linguistic category can be realized, yeah, by speakers in two or more different ways. That's a sociolinguistic variable. All of this sounds pretty abstract, so let me give you a few examples. Sorry. So, sociolinguistic variables, we have the word variable in there, so it's clear it's about variation. And many linguistic structures, in fact, have variants. Variants are all over the place. You find them at each level of linguistic structure. Now, most work in sociolinguistics has actually focused on variation in the domain of sounds, the domain of phonology. Yeah. So a famous sociolinguistic variable is the post-vocalic R, whether or not you pronounce an R in words like car or deer. Yeah, you can also say car or deer. and you know that, okay, this is a sociolinguistic variable that distinguishes, for instance, between speakers of American English and speakers of British English. Brits and Americans are also distinguished by the tomato-tomato variable. Yeah, and there are a couple of others that we could mention. In each case, one linguistic category, consonant, yeah, or a vowel, is realized in two or more different ways by different kinds of speakers. That's all there is. Right. Variation also happens in morphology. Think, for instance, of negation, the way you can negate a sentence. You could either say, I'm not going, or you could say, I ain't going. And the people who say, I ain't going, aren't necessarily the same. We're saying, I'm not going. Yeah, so social groups use different variants. there are also variants that are not necessarily related to anything social. For instance, the distinction prouder or more proud. There's not a social group that would, you know, always use more proud instead of prouder. Rather, this is something that is not socially conditioned. It has other reasons that I'll talk about in a minute. In syntax, there's also variation. For instance, if we take the second example here, I gave John the book expresses the same thing as I gave the book to John. Yeah, both mean the same things, but syntactically they're different. Yeah, the positions of the objects are different, and again, this is not something that would have social explanations, but rather it is something that has processing explanations or semantic explanations. Okay, to return to the sociolinguistic variable. The sociolinguistic variable is typically a binary choice so that speakers have the choice between doing one thing or another thing. Yeah? They have to do one of those and they have to settle for one. So, for instance, this could be the choice between I'm not and I ain't. Now, it is not the case that any speaker would settle for just one of these. There can be speaker internal variation, that is, speakers sometimes produce one variant on one occasion and a different variant on another occasion. Yeah, could depend on who they're talking to, what the situation is, if they're amongst their friends or if they're talking to a superior at work, that kind of thing. Right. This also means that speakers cannot be divided into discrete categories, but rather they have to be placed somewhere along a continuum. So I can be a very heavy user of I ain't, or I can be a moderate user of both, or I can be an exclusive user of I'm not. So in my idiolect, ain't occurs very, very rarely. All right. Now, the project of sociolinguistics, so to speak, is to explain why a speaker produces one variant rather than another. Yeah, so that you could, for instance, look at my social profile, yeah, who I am, and then make an educated guess about how often I would be saying I'm not or I ain't. So, what are then these factors that would allow sociolinguists to explain variation? There are two important types, namely language internal factors and language external factors. Talking about language internal factors first, those are factors that have to do with the structures and meanings of language itself. They're linguistic. And I've given you a few examples here. So the variation between more clever and cleverer is to a certain extent phonologically conditioned, so that American speakers prefer the periphrastic variant here, more clever, because they're speaking erotic variety, and so pronouncing a word like cleverer, there are these two R's at the end of the word, and that is quite hard to pronounce. So there's a phonological explanation why Americans would rather say more clever than cleverer. Yeah? More clever is easier to pronounce, and presumably it's also easier to understand than cleverer. Yeah? Then the second example here concerning the variation between the two double object constructions. Yeah, the first one here, I gave the book to the old man at the counter. That sounds like a good sentence of English. Whereas I gave the old man at the counter the book. That's also a possible sentence of English. But then again, speakers disprefer this variant. They don't say it as often. And they don't say it as often because you see the underlined part there, the old man at the counter, that's a very heavy, very long constituent. And speakers of English in general like to have these big, chunky constituents at the end of a sentence. We talked about this in pragmatics. That's the principle of end weight. Yeah, that's one principle. You like to have the long constituents at the end because when they're there, they're easier to process. Okay, here in the red example, I gave the old man at the counter the book. You have to process this long thing before you know what the end of the sentence is. Yeah, so you have to keep a lot of stuff in working memory, and people disprefer that. Right, so that would be a syntactic or processing explanation of why people prefer one variant over the other. Yeah. And then the third example here is about the two genitives of English. English has two genitives, one with the genitive s and one with the preposition of. And also there you have a choice, right? You could say the cost of living, or you could say the living's cost. And well, the cost of living is actually the much better way to express this particular idea, because the S genitive goes along with a certain semantics, with a certain meaning, namely that the thing with the S attached to it should be a living, breathing, animate possessor, okay? A person, John's book, or my cat's food, things like that. So the cost of living is preferred because its meaning is a better fit for the structure that we're using. So these are language internal factors. They are solely concerned with language at the level of phonology, syntax, or semantics, and they are not so much concerned with things outside language, and those I'll talk about now, language external factors. So these are factors that relate to non-linguistic issues, social categories like age or gender, ethnicity, mobility, and so on and so forth. To give you also a few examples here, so the variation between, for instance, gonna and going to, yeah. One is the contracted variant, if you like, the other is the more full variant. Here we observe an asymmetry that is related to age, so that young speakers use gonna more often than older speakers. And here we have age as an explanation. Nothing from within language, but rather something outside language that determines speakers' choices between those two variants. Then there's quite a bit of older sociolinguistic research that has analyzed the use of hedges in male and female speakers. So apparently, well, at least in those older studies, female speakers used to hedge statements with tag questions more often than their male peers. So female speakers more often attach something like isn't it, didn't she, wasn't it, to their sentences than males. Males would rather leave something as is, so they would say nice weather today and not add the isn't it. Right, so here we would have gender as an explanation. People of one gender like to do something, people of another gender don't do it to the same extent. Right, I already talked about tomatoes and tomatoes, yeah? That is geography as an explanation. People in one area of the world do this, people in another area of the world do a different thing. Class, socioeconomic status, that is another variable that determines the choices that speakers make. So British upper class speakers are more likely than middle class speakers to produce a trill in words like very. Okay, so that would be something like very. I'm very concerned about. Well, you insert something there. All right, those are language external factors. And sociolinguistics has been mostly concerned with these language external factors. So I've talked about people's choices between variants, and that may have given you the idea that people are making these choices consciously, that they're thinking about, okay, what am I going to use? Oh, I'm a woman, so I'd rather insert a tag question. Well, that's not how it works. It's really subconsciously. Everything is beneath your own level of consciousness. It is rather your brain only that makes these choices. Your consciousness doesn't have anything to do with it. So, now, when I talk about, wait a second. So, when I say that language internal factors and language external factors influence how people talk, that is something that can be fairly accurately measured, yeah? So, for instance, you could record somebody's spontaneous conversation, and you could identify all passages where a speaker has a choice to produce either variant A or variant B of something. Okay, so for instance, you could count all instances of the be going to construction, and you could determine how often people say gonna and how often going to, the full variant. Okay, and what interests you is the ratio of the two variants, whether somebody says gonna in 90% of all cases or whether they say gonna just in 10% of all cases. So where it gets interesting, of course, is when you have different social groups who differ according to those ratios. So you have one social group who has a 90% ratio of gonna, and you have another social group that only has a 10% ratio of gonna. Differences in such measurements are sociolinguistic effects of these factors. And I've given you two examples here of so-called main effects, where one variable has a measurable impact on what people say. So if the realization of a sociolinguistic variable depends on a certain factor, that factor can be said to have a main effect. And in the first graph here, you see a main effect of gender. So you have four bars. You have old and young females and old and young males. And you see that the old and young females are at about 50%, and the males, old and young, are at about 25%. So that means that there's a reliable difference between female speakers and male speakers. And this would be called a main effect of gender in this case. Yeah, gender is the variable that makes people talk differently. So this could be an example of, for instance, tag questions. Yeah, female speakers, regardless of age, use more tag questions than their male counterparts. In the second graph, on the lower half of the slide here, you see a different main effect. So in this case, we have a difference not between females and males. The two graphs look, the two sets of bars look very, very similar. But rather, this time, the difference concerns age rather than gender. So old females pattern just like the old males, and young females pattern just like the young males. So here, an example might be, you know, the rate of gonna, that young people say gonna more often than going to, and the old people, when they use the be going to construction, they most often say going to, the full variant, rather than gonna, the contracted variant. All right, so this would be the simplest scenario of a social category having an effect on how people talk, a main effect of a sociolinguistic factor. But often things are more complicated than that. There are so-called interaction effects. So this means that sometimes a factor has an effect, but only in connection with a second factor. That's called an interaction effect. And an interaction effect is shown in the graph you see here. So again, we have the four bars. We have females, old and young, males, old and young. And here you see that there is, well, something special going on with young females. Okay, everybody else patterns more or less the same. Yeah, old females, old and young males, they are at about 25%, and it's just the females that stick out. So this is an interaction effect of gender and age. What it means is being female has an effect, but only if you're young. Okay, so that's the pattern of an interaction. Something has an effect, but only if a second thing also comes in. Yeah, you have to be female and you have to be of young age. Then the effect obtains. If these two conditions are not met, then nothing happens. So, what could be an example for this? Well, it's been suggested that the discourse marker, the quotative like, yeah, when you introduce something that you have said or something somebody else has said with the word like, I was like, who told you that? Or I was like, wow, that's totally awesome. That is something that adolescent females have introduced into the speech community. And by now the bars maybe look a little different. So also young males and even older people are picking it up. So interaction effect. A little bit complicated. If you've understood this, you've understood a whole lot. To many people, interaction effects are a mystery. Right. Speaking of effects, there is one important thing that I need to mention, and that is the concept of a confound. A confound means that something looks like it has an effect. Yeah, the appearance is there that a factor has a main effect, but this appearance is in effect false. So look at the first figure here, the first two bars. What this looks like is that there's a main effect of class, of socioeconomic status. So we have the working class people at 50%, and we have the middle class people at 25%. So that looks like, well, class evidently has a major effect on how people talk. However, this effect is only apparent. There's something hidden in the data that gives us this idea that class has an effect, but it's actually not there. So look at the second graph. If we partition the data for ethnicity, so we look at all the people that we recorded and we control for their ethnicity, then it seems like the effect is not due to class, but rather due to ethnicity. So in both cases here, working and middle class, we had about the same amount of Anglo persons in there, okay? But in the working class bar, we had lots and lots more Afro speakers than in the middle class bar, yeah? This distorts our measurements. So the Afro group is overrepresented in the working class people. And so what we have here is really more of an effect of ethnicity rather than social class. And you can imagine that if you sort of take the second bar apart and put the Anglo bars next to the Afro bars, then you see that it's really more of a main effect of ethnicity and not class. However, if you don't control for the variable of ethnicity, then it looks like an effect of class. So in this case, we would say that ethnicity confounds the effect of class. So the goal in sociolinguistic research would be to control for as many variables as possible in order not to have these confounds that might call into question the results of your study. Okay. That's everything I wanted to say conceptually about sociolinguistic variables. Now let us look at a few data examples of sociolinguistic variables that are given by Milroy and Gordon in the chapter. So one classic variable is the British H-dropping variable. That is the difference between hammer and ammer with a glottal stop. I can't do that very well. So the table that Milroy and Gordon give you is shown here. So we're talking about two cities, Bradford and Norwich. So Norwich is about here, and Bradford is about here, north of Manchester, and Norwich is here in East Anglia. And When you look at these numbers in the table, it's quite hard to see what's going on. So I graphed these numbers in a chart like this one here. What you have again are the ratios of age dropping. That's the ratio of age dropping, high age dropping, low age dropping. And here you have the different social categories. So upper middle class, lower middle class, upper working, middle working, lower working. Okay, and what you see is that, okay, the lower working classes and the middle working classes, they have the highest ratio of age dropping. Now, you notice also that it is sort of the same. The curve is more or less the same in Bradford and in Norwich. So we see the same effect of class influencing age dropping across the two cities. What this means is that in the Hammer-Ammer variable, we have a main effect of class. It's class that matters. And lower class, so the further we go to the right in the graph, the higher the rate of age dropping gets. So lower class correlates with more age dropping. The poorer you are, the fewer H's you can afford, you could say. Yeah. Okay, next example. This is a little bit more complex. This time, Milroy and Gordon even give you two tables instead of just one. And there are not just two possibilities, H or no H. Rather, there are four different variants to produce a vowel. And in this case, the vowel that they're talking about is the goat vowel, as in goat. And I say goat, which is sort of diphthongy, goat. But we've already talked about in one of the sessions that in Northern England and in Scotland, the goat vowel can be realized differently. Many speakers say something like goat, I have an example, but I can't show you that right now. So, we're in Newcastle upon Tyne, Northern England, and so we are looking at four different variants of the goat vowel. So, good, goat, goat, and goat. You see that nobody really uses goat like I do. And we're looking at middle class and working class people, men and women, and young people and old people. So all these variables are crossed, and we want to know who does what. Wow. So that's already very complex. Yeah, that's a very complex data set. And you see here, WC, that means working class, 45 to 65, that's the age. And we have working class, 16 to 24, middle class, 45 to 65, and middle class, 16 to 24. The first table is about women, and the second table is about men. All right, so you have these four realizations, three social variables, class, gender, and age, and you get all these numbers. And that makes it so, I find it difficult. So again, to understand these things a little better, I made a graph here. Here we have the ratio of the O realization, gold. And we have working class people, middle class people, and the three lines here correspond to, well, females, that's the dark blue line. Then for males, we have old males, that's the green one, and young males, that's the strange green one. And wait a second, I got to pause this a little bit here.